Of over a million species of animals on our planet, one species has come to dominate all other life forms and to alter dramatically the face of the Earth. It's a species that, if we remove its protective layer of clothing, reveals a rather strange anatomy. A species I once referred to as the naked ape. Physically, the human being is a puny primate with a vulnerable, unprotected skin, with no natural weapon, no armor, no sharp spines, no venom, no fangs or claws. Yet equipped with little more than an enlarged brain, this compulsively curious creature has come to dominate the natural world. What is the secret of its lavish, unprecedented success? Anatomically, the human animal is unusual, to say the least. Its lack of hair is unique among primates. Contrasting with other apes, its face has a protruding nose, whites to the eyes, and lips that are turned inside out. Its legs are long and straight, and unlike any other mammal, it walks bipedally. The breasts of the female remain swollen throughout her adult life, even when they're not giving milk. Again, a unique feature. There are a few surviving patches of hair, including on the tops of the heads, in the armpits, and around the genitals. The male has the largest penis of any primate. And the human animal is the only primate that possesses rounded, fleshy buttocks. Altogether, these unique features make us a very strange ape indeed. And for a student of animal behavior, even more peculiar than its anatomy are its activities in the wild. I'm a zoologist, and since man is an animal, I can see no reason why my work and also in this series, I shouldn't study this particular species in the same way that I've studied many other animals in the past. And the secret is patient observation. For me, the ideal method is to go out into the field and study humans in their natural environment, in the streets and parks, the shops and offices, the villages and cities, to analyze their natural behavior as it happens in real-life situations all over the world. Everywhere I go, I'm struck by how similar all human beings are to one another in all important respects. Of course, there are many superficial differences, and these are often so impressive that we pay too much attention to them and start treating one another as if we belong to different species, with disastrous results. But despite all our variations in costume, ritual, and belief, biologically, we're all astonishingly close to one another, a fact which I find very reassuring. Back in the late 1960s, I was sitting in this very restaurant on the island of Malta, talking to my publisher. I drew his attention to the fact that over the other side of the road, there were two men who were gesticulating in a particular way. The way they were holding their palms to one side was fascinating me. And he said, you know, you look at people the way that a bird watcher looks at birds. And I said, yeah, I suppose you could call me a man watcher. As soon as I said it, it was as if I'd fired a starting gun on a major new project, one that was to engross me for many years to come and take me to over 60 different countries. It was wildly ambitious, but I decided to make a complete classification of all human actions, gestures, postures, expressions, all over the world. And this is going to take a very long time. I was going to do for actions what dictionary makers had done for words. I began making huge charts naming every facial expression, every gesticulation, every movement, every posture. I kept at it for month after month.
And 8 years later, I'd completed the work and was able at last to introduce people to the fascinating subject of human body language.
One of the first problems I encountered was that even the simplest human action, such as the handshake, has countless variations. Sometimes it's reduced to a mere palm touch, as with these Maasai elders in East Africa. But in other countries it becomes more elaborate. In Mali, in West Africa, the handshaker briefly touches his own forearm as the palms clasp. In Morocco, the handshakers kiss one another's hands at the same time as clasping them. And in Turkey, these Kurdish farmers have taken this simple action and converted it into what amounts to a minor ritual. It's the local rule that they can't start bargaining until they're shaking hands. They have to keep on doing so until the deal is struck. The essential feature of handshaking is that it's an egalitarian act. Regardless of their social standing, the two people involved are momentarily performing identical actions. This meeting as equals that has spread around the world is comparatively recent. In earlier times, when greeting, it was common for the less important individuals to literally lower themselves as a sign of respect. In some remote parts of the world, we can still see this even today. The Toda people of South India still perform this body-lowering ritual with high-status feet placed on low-status heads. Despite their variations, all these greetings have one thing in common. They're all fine-tuned to the precise context in which they occur.
So many gestures have different meanings in different places. You have to be quite careful how you use your hands when you're in a marketplace in a foreign country. Now, to me, this means everything's fine, okay. But if I happen to be in the south of France, it would have a quite different meaning. There, the ring shape made by the hand symbolizes a naught or a zero. So in the south of France, this means zero or worthless. So you don't want to say the wine was great because, in fact, you're saying the wine was worthless. It gets even worse if you go to Sardinia because there, the same gesture is an obscenity with the ring shape symbolizing an orifice. And if you think you're going to say that something is great in Sardinia like this, believe me, you'll be in trouble. There's another way that you can make mistakes with gestures as you move from place to place, because a single message is given in a different way in different countries. The crazy sign. How do you say to somebody, you're crazy? Well, here in Rome, you do this. But in England, I would probably do this, the temple screw, saying he's got a screw loose. Or I might say his brain is going round and round. Or I might tap my head, saying, what does he think he's got inside his skull? In some countries, you do it with two hands. It varies from place to place. And if you go to Japan, you have to be careful, because if you do it this way, it means he's intelligent. You have to do it in an anti-clockwise direction in Japan if you want to say that somebody is crazy. So all over the world, the same message is given in a slightly different way.
One of the most obvious examples of this, and one of the most dangerous, is the insult gesture. This Turkish pedestrian displays his anger with the thrust of a stiff forearm, using his arm symbolically as an aggressively erect penis. A slightly more obscure insult is the cornuta, or horn sign, frequently seen in Italy. It implies that the victim of the insult is a cuckold, that his wife is unfaithful to him. In North America, the most common insult is the middle finger jerk, employing the index finger as a symbolic penis. This is an ancient Roman gesture and is well known in many countries. Much more localized is the Greek moutsa. This dates back to Byzantine times and symbolizes excrement being pushed into the victim's face. In Britain, the main insult is a two-fingered gesture, which dates back to the Battle of Agincourt. It's a gesture that foreigners sometimes confuse with the V for victory sign, but that's performed with the hand the other way around. Most regional body language has a long and complicated history, with the origins often forgotten.
One of the special qualities of regional gestures is that they're amazingly conservative. They remain confined to their own particular area, regardless of the fact that all around them national boundaries keep changing. As a result of this, within a particular country today, you can find what we could call a gesture frontier, a place where one gesture stops and another one begins. This is a gesture frontier behind me. It's the Massica range in central Italy. And south of here in Naples, people use, for example, the head toss when they're saying no. Up in the north, in Rome, they shake their heads from side to side when they're saying no. And we were amazed to find that here, at the Massica range, is a very narrow area, just a few miles, where you get the switch from head tossing to head shaking.
The explanation of this switch is astonishing. In origin, the head toss is a Greek gesture, and many centuries ago, the ancient Greeks colonized southern Italy and started to move north. And it was here at the Massica range that they stopped their advance 2,500 years ago. And to this day, in the north, people still give the typical European head shake when saying no. While in the south, they still give the ancient Greek head toss. And this difference has survived despite all the mobility of modern life and the spread of films and television programs. The old gesture frontier remains. Yes signals made with the head are just as complicated as no signals. In most parts of the world, people nod the head up and down when saying yes. Many people mistakenly assume that this action is completely global, but this isn't the case. There are two areas where something else happens. One of them is India, where instead of being nodded, the head is wobbled from side to side when saying yes. To visitors, this looks like a maybe, but it's not. It's a sign of definite agreement. When your taxi driver agrees with you, you can see his head rolling from side to side, and you get the impression that he's undecided. But every wobble he makes means yes.
Do you find people excited by these, or is it just really?
In another region altogether, it's not just the visitors who are confused. Even the inhabitants are not always sure what's going on. Here in Bulgaria, they use both the head nod and the head wobble when saying yes, which creates total confusion. Why on earth they should do this remains a mystery, even to them. Although gestures often persist for hundreds or even thousands of years, sometimes they may change their meaning as they're passed on from generation to generation. We all think we know what the popular thumbs up and thumbs down gestures mean. If we go to the cinema, we're left in little doubt as to the significance of these gestures.
The thumbs up for good and the thumbs down for bad are very well-known gestures, and many people can tell you how they began. It was here in the Colosseum in Rome. If a gladiator at the end of a fight was to be spared, the crowd gave him a thumbs up sign.
If he was to be slain, it was a thumbs-down sign. Now, that's the popular story. There's just one catch. It's completely false. It never happened like that. In ancient times, if the gladiator was to be spared, they gave him a covered-up thumb, the pollice compresso, compressed or squashed thumb. They hid their thumbs. If he was to be slain, then they mimed the act of stabbing him with a sword like this. And because they were high up, of course, they stabbed downwards like that. That's the truth of the matter, and the next time you go to the movies, if you happen to see the thumbs up, you'll just have to take it with a pinch of salt. It's almost certain that our ancestors used gestures to communicate specific information long before they had a spoken language. Even today, with words as our main form of communication, there are still situations where gestures have a definite advantage. For example, they can communicate information over a far greater distance than would be possible by shouting. At racetracks in England, the white-gloved tic-tac men signal changes in the betting odds to the bookies so that they can keep up with the alterations their rivals may be making.
They all get shorter. God, they're all getting bigger. Anything gets smaller.
11 at 10,
yeah.
The flashing movements of the white gloves can be seen even at night and at a great distance. In some sports, a gestural sign language not only conveys information over a great distance, but also allows messages to be kept secret. The coach of an American football team transmits complex signals to his quarterback using coded hand signals that conceal his intentions from the opposing team. Even if the opposing team does manage to crack the gestural code at any one time, it's being constantly changed to confuse them. On the floor of the Bombay Stock Exchange, hand gestures provide a powerful tool when competing for attention. The frantic sell and buy signals, indicated by the position of the hands, can be the basis of huge deals, an insistent flick of the fingers being the only way to attract attention above the roar of the crowd. In the eerie silence of the Australian outback, these two Walpiri women are conversing quite adequately by gestures alone. Now, they're not deaf and they're perfectly capable of speech, but local custom demands that as an act of mourning, they don't utter a word for months after a tribesman has died. It's their version of wearing black. Clearly, gestures are important to us, but why are we so much better at signalling with our hands than other animals? The answer, of course, is that we are the only mammals that are bipedal. They are all quadrupedal. They walk along on all fours. But when we stood up on our hind legs millions of years ago here in Africa, we freed our hands from the business of walking. We freed them from the chore of locomotion, and that was what enabled them to become the flexible, gesticulating hands that we have today. In order to appreciate what an immense impact the simple act of standing up had on our primeval ancestors, it's only necessary to watch our nearest living relatives, the chimpanzees. When they're moving about in their natural habitat, their hands still have to function for much of the time as plodding front feet, and this prevents them from becoming highly developed as expressive organs of gesture. Their front feet can operate successfully as grasping hands, for example, when holding a baby, but they never develop the subtlety of movement that we see in our own species. Elegant gesturing remains the prerogative of the uniquely bipedal naked ape. So far, all the gestures that I've described have been regional, and they're used consciously to replace speech, like the deliberate directions of this policeman. But there's another type of gesture altogether. Unconscious hand movements, usually referred to as gesticulations. Instead of replacing speech, they accompany it. This type of hand signal has been christened the baton gesture because it beats time to our words and emphasizes the points we're making. But baton gestures do much more than merely beat time. They also indicate our changing moods, the posture of the hand as it beats the air, revealing the emotional state of the speaker. Here at Speaker's Corner in London's Hyde Park, a veritable gallery of human baton gestures is on display. Let's watch for a moment. Now let's take a closer look at two of his gestures. Slowing it down, his first gesture is a repelling action, using his hand as if it were pushing away the intruder, but without making physical contact. This is obvious enough, but what does he do next? As the intruder leaves, he draws his chosen audience back towards him using an air grasp gesture. There. Another speaker is about to mention a precise date and unconsciously accompanies this with a precision gesture, as if holding a small object with great delicacy between his thumb and forefinger. A third speaker is in a more aggressive mood. He's using not a precision grip, but a power grip, thrusting his clenched fist at the audience. The power of his fist reflecting the power of his argument. But now he switches to the raised forefinger, beating his listeners over the head with his small symbolic club. And finally, he extends his hands, palm up, in an imploring gesture, begging them to agree with him. By contrast, this speaker employs the palm down gesture, a more dominant action in which he attempts to calm his audience by symbolically patting them on the head, as if they're unruly children.
And the apostle of Jesus.
Finally, this man introduces the hand chop gesture, a decisive gesture in which he symbolically tries to cut through the argument as if with a sharp blade.
Mm-hmm.
The urge to express our emotions with our hands is so strong that we continue to gesticulate even when the person we're talking to is miles away at the other end of a telephone line. Communicate by body language is so deeply ingrained that if we happen to be Japanese, we even bow respectfully to our remote, invisible companion. But there's another whole facet of body language that conveys our emotions with even greater subtlety. We humans have the most expressive faces in the entire animal kingdom. We take our expressions rather for granted, but if we trace them back to their origins, it's interesting to see how they evolved. The chimpanzee's face is almost as expressive as the human's. And if we watch these apes in the wild, we can begin to see how we acquired our own highly mobile faces. Originally, facial muscles were needed not for communication, but for other more basic functions. To move the lips, for instance, improving their role in drinking and feeding. As the apes suck, chew and bite, their powerful, sensitive lips explore each object as it comes into contact with the mouth. This involves a great deal of pulling and stretching, and when they're young, the infant apes employ their long lips as valuable sucking organs, squeezing milk from their mother's nipples. But even the chimpanzee is no match for the rubber-faced human being.
First, I will show you how I kiss my girlfriend.
But in Cumberland, they ignored the overseas challenge and elected Albert Benison of Consett, County Durham, ugliest man in the world.
If we could see below the surface of the human face, we'd discover the most complicated set of facial muscles in the world. These muscles give us a huge range of expressions. Some big and bold, others extremely subtle. But humans and chimps don't just share a flexible face. We also share many of the same expressions. It's not hard for us to appreciate that these young apes are in a playful mood by simply looking at their faces. And if we watch the way in which chimps work themselves up into a violent mood, it's easy for us to understand what's happening. Whenever an animal goes on the attack, it's always slightly fearful of retaliation. As a result, we see a face in conflict. The tightness of the lips around the mouth is a sure sign of primate aggression, while the lowered eyebrows indicate that the attacker is protecting its eyes in case of a fight. The same tight-lipped face is also seen in our own species in moments of great emotional intensity.
Get back now! I'll take somebody's head off. Get back! Get back!
Go on the officer!
Get your head back!
And there it is, the tight mouth of anger. This leaves no doubt as to the mood of these women, especially when combined with an intense stare.
One of the most primeval of all facial expressions is the staring eye. It's something we share with other animals, and it's always threatening. And because of this, in earlier centuries, people thought there was something they called the evil eye, a mystical force that, by staring at them, could do them harm. To protect themselves against this evil eye, they would often try to outstare it. To do this, they made effigies of eyes which were unblinking and could perform a permanent stare to frighten away the evil spirits. Fishermen, when they went to sea, wanted to protect their boats, and they did so by giving their boats a staring eye.
And all over the Mediterranean, fishing boats are protected with elaborately painted and eternally unblinking eyes. Because hard stares are so assertive, some military and prison rituals employ them in a special way. At this correctional camp in Maryland, these prisoners are forbidden to stare, even to glance, at their prison officers. The officers, who are not allowed to lay a hand on the prisoners, make their dominance felt by the most direct and intense staring they can muster. And the effect is one of acute intimidation and almost painful humiliation.
Inmate Williams,
sir.
Can you hear me, Inmate Williams?
Sorry, yes, sir.
Stand up, Inmate Williams!
Sorry, yes, sir.
I'm on my toes! Stand up!
Sorry, yes, sir!
I don't want to see an eyeball on me, nowhere near me. If you don't hurry up, I'll put your butt out of here. Don't look at me, and you better stop pressing me. I don't give a crap about your attitude today. Last thing you're going to have attitude is about here around me. Stand up! Care about your attitude? You all over, goddamn dummy over there. Why you want to look at me, huh?
You don't want to freaking do it. That's all you got to do. Just quit. Ain't nobody ask you to come here. Ain't nobody gonna beg you to stay.
Put your legs together.
Udaria! Hurt!
If you thought that staring was pretty intimidating, there's one culture that takes it even further. This is the Maori haka, the aggressive challenge of the indigenous people of New Zealand, an ancient threat display still employed today in a modern context. Taking another look at those aggressive chimpanzees, what happens if they start to become alarmed and fearful, if their courage begins to desert them? As they become more and more afraid, their expressions undergo an important change. Their mouth corners are pulled back further and further. This is the typical fear face of all primates, including our own species. Way to prove just how closely we share this expression is to examine the faces of the panic-stricken customers on the latest fairground terror ride, the spiraling nemesis. Just as with frightened chimps, these mouth corners are pulled right back, exposing all the teeth. Of this expression is that it looks, in some respects, like the human smile. Smiling is a uniquely human expression that has evolved from the ancient fear face. This may sound odd because we think of smiling as friendly, not fearful. But there's a crucial link between the two. The fear face is sometimes used as a submissive signal, saying, in effect, I'm scared, therefore I'm not a threat to you. In other words, it's an anti-aggressive action. It's only a small step from I am not aggressive to I am friendly, and that's how the human smile evolved. Because of the smile's anti-aggressive origins, witnessing it makes onlookers feel at ease and responsive to the smiler. For this reason, it's been a mainstay of commercial advertising for many years.
Thirst is a candy mint. Thirst is a breath mint.
Stop! You're both right. New Thirst is two mints in one. Stops bad breath in seconds. Tastiest mint of all.
Year after year after year. Lucky lot.
The problem for these professional smilers, however, is that it's difficult to fake the expression perfectly. The fixed smile gives the game away. For synchronized swimmers, the physical exertions of their sport make it even harder to fake a convincing smile. They have to keep on smiling to impress the judges, but it's not easy. One of the best places to observe the false smile is on the faces of the beachside photographer's customers.
That's it, beautiful. Just in a bit more. Beautiful, smile. Come on, smile.
But how precisely do we know that this smile falls short of being convincing? The essential feature is that the specialized muscles that pull the mouth corners up and the ones around the eyes that create the smiling eyes are both much harder to control consciously than the more ancient ones that simply pull the mouth corners back. No matter how hard we try, we can't fabricate the perfect smile. This incredibly strong link between our facial expressions and the inner workings of our body has been put to very good use by imaginative doctors in America who've taken the radical step of clowning in hospital wards.
Ah, oh, that's it.
I think you're having a little too much fun, you know. Oh. You're having so much fun, you know, they might kick you out of here or something like that. Boy, look at all the stuff you got in here. You got a lot of great stuff.
Although this may appear to be a bizarre form of medical care, its impact is extraordinary. By making patients smile and laugh, their pain levels are reduced. Their happy facial expressions actually release endorphins, the body's natural painkillers, into their systems.
Just well, we'll wait for later to do that.
Please come back.
Yeah, we'll come back later for that, okay?
Oh, oh, he broke his head.
Oh, boy. You know, just, I think you ought to be a doctor like me.
Amazingly, the laughter created by this clowning works as well as any pain-killing drug, such as the power of human body language.
The pacifier!
Bless you.
Hi!
Because our body language reveals our true feelings, we often try to suppress it, to hide our fears and anxieties, our longings and our hostilities. But it's such an efficient communication system that we usually give away a few telltale signs. Now, for most of us, that's an everyday social challenge. But for some people, it's much more than that.
For professional poker players, the suppression of body language is a way of life. For them, even the tiniest hint of emotion can cost a fortune. Here at the annual World Poker Contest in Las Vegas, $1 million in cash is piled onto the table to be won or lost on the final play of the cards. The finalists around the table are the best players in the world, and needless to say, they're masters of body language control. They epitomize the so-called poker face. But even they are not entirely immune to the urges of human body language. Careful studies of the telltale signs of poker players have revealed that there are several vital clues that can tell you when a hand is good or bad and when a player is bluffing. When a player has a bad hand, he stares at his cards a little longer. When a player has a good hand, his blink rate increases slightly. When he has a good hand, he looks away for a split second. When he has a bad hand, he bets with a flourish. But these particular players, world champions, in addition to being able to suppress their own facial expressions and their telltale gestures, are also masters of reading the body language of their competitors.
Jim's got a jack six. Dan needs a seven and a four, otherwise Jim Ducter becomes the 24th world champion. Five, Jim Ducter becomes our...
And this is the victor, but watch his face. This man has just won $1 million, but his expressions are so tightly under control that even now he can't show any emotion. There's no smile, no shouting for joy. His poker face is like a mask. All he allows himself eventually is a little jab in the air with a triumphant forefinger.
40-46.
Most of us would make poor poker players because we're so bad at lying. We give away our true feelings despite all our efforts to conceal them.
Your wallet? I found a phone book. I thought it was money.
This woman has just been accused of stealing somebody's purse, and just by looking at her body language, it's possible to spot certain clues that suggest that her denials are false.
See, I had one like that too.
Yeah,
okay, well, then mine is in your car or something.
Let's see your ID.
She brings her hand up to her mouth as if to hide the lie that she's telling. Face touching is often a sign of attempted deception.
How'd you get the purse?
I got a ride.
Where'd you find it?
It was on the floor, and I automatically thought it was mine.
And she uses the hand shrug gesture, an unconscious disclaimer that usually increases in frequency when lying is taking place.
Well, if you thought it was yours, then you just got through telling me.
And her eyes blink and close more than usual, an unconscious attempt to shut out the outside world, to cut herself off from the tension of the lie.
I put it in my bag, and my bag was open, so I thought it was mine, okay? I picked this up and this up, too, automatically, and they're mine, too. Okay, the wallet was on the floor, and my mind's mixed up, okay? He don't want the baby, I want the baby, okay? So I just magically just start picking up the things that were on the floor. I'm sorry.
Some people seem to think that body language is trivial, but it should be clear by now that this is not the case. Indeed, at moments of desperation, we turn not just to spoken language, but beyond that to the more primeval language of the body, a signalling system that was used by our ancestors for millions of years before the first human words were uttered, and one that can still play a crucial role in ensuring an individual's survival. But even more far-reaching than this, body language is so powerful that it can change the course of history and affect the behaviour of literally millions of people, a fact that tyrants have not overlooked. For me, body language is far more than just a fascinating area of human biology. It's at the core of a whole new science, the study of human behaviour from a zoological perspective. And for this series too, body watching is only the beginning. Turning a zoological eye towards our own species, I'll be looking at the commonplace as well as the more unusual actions of the human animal. Why, for example, for a species which so often lives in a state of extreme overpopulation, is aggressive behaviour like this the exception rather than the rule? In fact, for the vast majority of the time, the human animal goes about its business in an amazingly ordered way. Every individual, even in the vast social system of a city, is aware of fitting into a very precise position in the social pattern. I'll be looking at the human animal's sexual behaviour. What biological mechanisms are at work when we choose a partner? And what influences why we find certain people attractive and others not? When it comes to the courtship ritual, what are our species' typical behaviour patterns? And why, at this time, do we so often display juvenile characteristics, such as the need to be spoon-fed? Parental behaviour. The bond between the human parent and its young is probably the strongest of any species in the world. And the effect of being separated can be quite devastating, especially for the parent.
We've got an attic. All's well. All's well. All right. All's well.
What is the biological function of rites of passage, ceremonies that mark the arrival of sexual maturity? And why do human individuals remain alive long after they cease to be able to bear children? Finally in this series, I'll be looking at those aspects of our behaviour that appear to have no parallels in the rest of the animal kingdom. Is the playful behaviour of our species really different from that seen in other animals? Is body decoration different from the elaborate and colourful display plumage of birds? What drives us to take serious risks, merely for the thrill of it? But before this, in the next episode, I'll turn my attention to one of our most fundamental activities, that of finding food. There's no other species that consumes such an incredible variety of food. In fact, we're so good at extracting nutrients from our environment that we're able to adapt to and exploit virtually every type of habitat on this planet. And with our modern lifestyle, what's happened to our ancestral hunting urges? Now, I've sometimes been accused of degrading mankind, of insulting human dignity, of making man beastly. This surprised me because I like animals and I feel proud to call myself one. I've never looked down upon them. So to call human beings animals is not, to me, degrading. It's simply being honest and putting us in our place as part of the scheme of nature on the planet Earth. Thank you.